is certainly worthy of all of our praise. Amen. You know, the enemy and those who serve the enemy, they make a whole lot of noise. Amen. But the Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Amen. And the only way this situation in our world is going to be turned around is when the people of God begin to make more noise for truth than other people make noise for untruth. Amen. And so we praise God from whom all of our wonderful blessings flow. Join me in prayer. God, we thank you. We thank you for a right now blessing. And God, we endeavor to give you a right now praise. And now, God, as we prepare, oh God, collectively to enter into your word, we ask God for a right now word. Some have come, Lord, with grief, and some with despair, some with discouragement. Some simply need to be encouraged to know, God, that they can keep on keeping on. Oh God, whatever the dynamics of our situation may be, we thank you, God, that your word gives us all that we need for life and for living. God, we know your word says there is a thief that comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But God, you came that we might have life and have it more abundantly. God, we thank you for your written word. We also thank you most of all for your living word, that Savior and soon coming King. Now, God, we pray, oh God, as we prepare our minds and our hearts and even our wills to heal from you, God, we just ask, Lord God, now that your spirit would provide the illumination upon your word that has been given. It's in the blessed name of Jesus Christ we pray. Let the people of God say amen.
Amen.
If you'll join me in Psalm 63. Psalm 63, and as you can see, I'm calling your attention simply to verse 1. We'll deal with all 11 verses, but I just want to read verse 1. When you have it, you just say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
And it says, O God, you are my God. I shall seek you earnestly. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh yearns for you in a dry and weary land where there is no water. This morning, as you were seated, and I thank you for standing to acknowledge the word of God, where you're not standing for me, we're just standing because God is speaking. Amen. This morning, I want to talk about factors that motivate. Factors that motivate. You know, all of us, we need some incentive. We need something to motivate us to do what we do. None of us does what we do, no matter what it may be, without something motivating us. As a matter of fact, whenever we are unmotivated, that's when we don't do anything. And whatever it may be, all of us, my brothers and sisters, are motivated by something or another. Some of us are motivated by fear. Some of us won't move, some of us won't do anything until we find ourselves at a point where we're so afraid that we've got to do it. Some of us are motivated by love and gratitude. We simply are motivated to do something because of love and gratitude. Some of us, and even all of us, should be motivated, my brothers and sisters, by the fear of the Lord. We ought to be motivated to serve the Lord, to praise the Lord, because the Lord has simply been so good to us. Amen? As a matter of fact, we should not have to look around very far to see how good it is that God has been, not just to some of us, but how good God has been to us. But I want you to know something else. There's power and there's motivation in desperation. And when we look at our text, we find David the psalmist, who is motivated by desperation. My brothers and sisters, as I enter this sermon on this morning, does it feel like you are barely hanging on? And I want you to understand something. The Bible, when it addresses individuals that feel like they are barely hanging on, the Bible unequivocally says, hang in there. As a matter of fact, when you read the Bible from Genesis to Revelation, you'll find over and over again people who are serving the Lord who find themselves barely hanging in there. And we understand that we are no different than those who are in the Bible. We find ourselves at moments in life where we are pressed against the corner and we are barely hanging in there. But the Bible says to us, hang in there. Listen, you ought to hang in there, because in seasons of brokenness, God has a graceful way of turning our most desperate situations into defining moments. God, when God enters our situation, God will turn our desperate situations into a defining moment. As a matter of fact, God will allow us to get to a point of desperation so that we will realize that He's all that we have and there's nowhere else to turn. Manly Beasley says that desperation always precedes illumination. Let me say that again. Desperation always precedes illumination. Because when you're desperate, God finally has your attention. Listen, as long as you have other alternatives, as long as you are placing your trust in other things, God does not have your complete attention. And so many of us are praying for God to bring us out, but at the same time, we are depending on something else to bring us out. So God will allow us to remain in a situation until we get to the point of desperation where God has our attention. I find so many of us over and over again getting to the point where we finally say, God, you know what? I give up. You've got my attention. And listen, when we give up and God has our attention, we are at the moment of experiencing breakthrough in our brokenness. Listen, in case you've checked out on me, we will all become desperate at some point, either from the drift of our own faithlessness or from the dive of faith. We will all become desperate at some point. And listen, because of our own sinfulness, we can be in the presence of God and never experience the help that God can offer, because our pride will not allow us to come desperate before the throne of grace. We're always trying to hold on to something, always trying to maintain all by ourselves. But the psalmist in our text teaches us, only when we allow the power of desperation to draw us to God can we experience breakthrough in our brokenness. Most of us never ever seek the Lord until we are forced to. Never pray. Never read the Bible. Don't think about church until we are forced to. Now listen, you can run from the Lord, but you can't hide. And God is a sovereign God, and He will orchestrate events to get us to the point where we acknowledge that He is the only one. See, the world offers some answers that will bring temporary relief. But God is the only one who can give answers that will give permanent hope. And so we need to understand, as we begin to look at this wonderful text coming from David, you first of all got to understand that the way up is the way down. In the Bible, the way up is the way down. C.S. Lewis says that God cannot bless us until He has us when we try to keep. No, God cannot bless us until He has us. When we try to keep within an area that is our own, we try to keep an area of death. Therefore, in love, God claims all of us. There is no bargaining with God. How many times when we're in a desperate situation do we say, God, if you, I will? Listen, you might as well stop right there, because none of us is in a position to bargain with God. So C.S. Lewis says, until God has all of us, He cannot bless us. And how many of us want to be blessed by God? But you can't be blessed by God. Listen, God is a jealous God. And until God has all of you, He is not going to give you all of Him. So you got to listen, like the old colloquialism said, you got to let go and let God. Let go of your pride. Let go of your self-sufficiency. Let go of your independence and let God work. Then we've also got to understand something about the sufficiency and the supply of God in the wilderness. David the psalmist is in the wilderness in our text. And I want you to understand the wilderness, my brothers and sisters, all throughout the Bible serves as a metaphor. The wilderness is the place where you are trying to figure out why the promises of God have not come true in your life. Wilderness is always a place where the people of God are always trying to figure out why the promises of God have not come true in their life. Listen, the path of life is not around the wilderness, but through the wilderness. When the children of Israel were brought out of Egypt, the most direct way would have been around the wilderness. But God took them through the wilderness. And you right now, just like the children of Israel, are wondering, God, why did you take me this way to get me to where you're trying to take me? And many of us are stagnant and have not been delivered from our brokenness. We're not experiencing the joy of the Lord because we still baffled because we're in the wilderness. Listen, in the Bible, God never takes us to the point of destination without bringing us through the wilderness. You can't give stuff to folk that have not proven that they can handle what you're going to give to them. You can't give stuff to folk who don't love you for who you are instead of what you give them. So the path of life and the path of peace and the path of joy, listen, it's never around the wilderness, but in the wilderness. So like David, you got to learn how to hit your high note in the wilderness. A lot of us, we don't hit our high note until we get to the destination. But a true child of God who knows God, like David, you can hit your high note in the wilderness. You sing your best song in a desolate place. You pray your best prayer in a destitute place. Because in a dry and weary land, all you got is God. So you realize the sufficiency and supply of God in the wilderness. Listen, Robert Bailey said in the wilderness experience, Robert Bailey says, he's a book entitled The Wilderness Experience. He says, the wilderness is an experience of contrast. He says it is an unsettled, barren, perilous area, but it is also the place where God is. The wilderness is an experience of contrast. It is a difficult, lonely, unnerving sight, but it's also the place where God dwells. The wilderness is an experience of contrast. It is a draining, exhausting, discouraging situation, but it's also the place where God heals and God strengthens. So if you are in the wilderness, if everything around you is falling apart, listen, God is right there. The psalmist said, where can I flee from your presence? Wherever you go, God is there. Psalm 63, David was in the wilderness, of his life. It was not of his own choosing. He was not there because of his own sin or unbelief, but David is in the wilderness because of the sinfulness of his son Absalom. Absalom, you'll find the background for him in 1 Samuel chapters 15 through 19. Here you have a son who didn't want to wait for his daddy to get off the throne. And he said, I'm just going to take over the throne and get rid of my daddy. And so Absalom started a rebellion. And David, fled to the wilderness. And he fled to the wilderness so he could spend some time with God. Now listen, David longed to get back to Jerusalem. And when David longed to get back to Jerusalem, found himself in the wilderness. And in the wilderness, listen, David was in the wilderness. But there was no wilderness in David's heart. Let me go back. Charles Haddon Spurgeon says this. There was no desert in David's heart, although David was in the desert. Listen, you might be in a destitute situation, but don't let being destitute be in your heart. You might be in a desperate situation, but don't let desperation be in your heart.
You may be in a lonely situation, but don't let loneliness enter your heart. Allow Jesus to be in your heart. Allow God to be in your heart. Listen, David did not allow the outside circumstances to dictate his praise. And for the child of God, when you know that you know that you know that you've been bought by the blood of the Lamb and that God is in control, it may not look good, but praise God anyhow.
I read the other day, and I want you to know something. God can be glorified even in social media. Amen. But I read somewhere the other day on Facebook, it said that when God closes a door, you ought to praise him in the hallway. Amen. If God closed it, he won't it close. If God shut you in, he won't you shut in. But a child of God got to be able to praise God no matter where they are. You ought to be able to sing and run and dance and praise God in the hallway of your life. Listen, David understood that God was with him wherever he was. Another wonderful book that you might want to take a look at is a book called A Little Pot of Oil. And Jill Briscoe says that all of us know what it feels like to run out of something or someone. Run out of money, run out of energy, run out of patience, run out of friends, run out of the ability to encourage ourselves. We all are going to run out of something or someone in our life. But there is one thing you never need run out of, and that is God. Listen, you need to always be filling yourself with God, because everything else is going to run out. But he said, whoever drinks of me shall never hunger and shall never thirst. Listen, as long as you are filling your cup with the joy of the Lord by reading his word, by praying, when you find yourself in those desperate situations of your life, you've got a resource coming from God that will allow you to stand, that will allow you to keep going even in your situation. Never run out of God. But then we've also got to be able to admit our desperate need for God. David in our text admits his desperate need for God. And listen, many of us have not gotten desperate enough to call out to God. But I want you to understand something. You will get desperate enough to call out to God. I will never, someone said, I will never despair because I have a God. But I will never presume because I am a man. Listen, never despair because you have a God. But never presume that you can get your own self out because you are but a mere human. The fact of the matter is, as long as we are serving the right God, the door is always open. As long as we are trusting God, there's always hope in your situation. As long as you acknowledge God, there is never a moment in your life that is without hope. So David, my brothers and sisters, in this psalm, he sings a song of desperation. We see a man of God seeking God at a deeper level than most of us have ever imagined. As his son Absalom is trying to rebel, David was driven into the wilderness. And in the wilderness, we see the passion of David. And as I made mention, David hit his high note in the desert. There's something about the crisis of desperation that will make a child of God call out to God in a way that is sincere. Whenever we find ourselves in a desperate moment, we don't pray those pretty prayers. We really prostrate ourselves and call out to God. We get straight to the point. We don't run through the litany of church history of talking about where the Lord has brought us from, what the Lord has done for us. We get to that situation quick, fast, in a hurry. Lord, I need you right now. I can't wait for tomorrow. And we need to understand, listen, my brothers and sisters, something about God. God always shows his power in the wilderness. God does not witness to the world by taking his people out of suffering. But God witnesses to the world by demonstrating his grace through us in the midst of our pain. Watchman Nee, a great Chinese theologian and missionary, he says the definition of a Christian is to hold on to the while you are wiping tears from your eyes. Being a Christian is to hold on to the plow while you are wiping tears from your eyes. Now, White's Watchman Nee, being a Chinese theologian, he gathered that from the Chinese symbol for the word crisis. Because the Chinese symbol for the word crisis represents both opportunity and danger. And so if you are at a desperate point in your life, you need to understand it may be a point of danger, but it's also a point of opportunity. You need to understand that when God brings you to the crossroads of your life, God is preparing to do something great in your life. But you've got to trust God and understand that God is providing for you an opportunity and not a closed door. David, like many of us, reaches a point where he has no other options. When David comes to God, meaning that he has abandoned every other alternative and has admitted his bankruptcy in the presence of the Lord. Listen, all of us, in order to be blessed by God, gotta file for spiritual bankruptcy. Until you file spiritual bankruptcy with the Lord, you are still saying, I can do it all by myself. But when you say, God, I'm bankrupt. God, I don't have nothing to give. All to you I give. Then you're in a position to be blessed. Listen, God is the only source of our hope and our living. Ernest Nagel, a skeptic and pessimist, said that the human destiny is an episode between two oblivions. That's a horrible way to live, living under an illusion that nothing makes a difference and that God is personal. But we serve a personal God, a God who sits high and a God who looks low, a God who will step in our situation and bring us out of whatever we are facing. That's why the Bible encourages us when we read it from cover to cover. We see that when folks are in desperate situations, God is able to bring them out. And I just want to remind us today that no matter what you find yourself in, it may be a life of sin, God is able to bring you out. You may be saved, but don't know where to go. God will bring you out. And God showed us how bankrupt we were on a hill called Calvary when his son Jesus Christ died on the cross. The Bible says, for our sins, he took upon himself what we deserve and gave us what we don't deserve. That's why God is blessing us right now. And we ought to give God a right now praise. My brothers and sisters, when we find ourselves in desperate situations, God, the Bible says, came not looking for those who were well. He came looking for those who are in desperate situations. If the doctors have given up on you, he's a doctor in a sick room. If won't nobody take your case, he's a lawyer in a courtroom. If won't nobody die for you, and thank God for that, because their blood ain't good enough. Jesus already paid it all. It all. To him we go. And so when we find ourselves in those moments, God says, glean power from your desperation and realize that no matter how low you go, that the love of God will lift you and propel you to higher heights. Listen, someone here today is in a very desperate situation. You've tried. You try to do it all by yourself and it keeps falling apart. You try to fix it and it breaks over and over again. You try to buy your way out. You try to connive your way out. But it don't work. Listen, the only way out for any of us is the blood of Jesus Christ. And so if you're at the point of desperation, what we have to offer you is the saving and cleansing blood of Jesus Christ. That Lamb of Calvary that died on that cross and rose, that you might have a new start in life. And so as the deacons come and as we stand, if you need a new start in life, if you're tired and weary of trying to fix it all by yourself, I want you to know that Jesus paid it all. He gave it all. He hung his head and died in order that you might have a new and fresh start in life. And listen, that fresh start, it's not that it'll be without trial and tribulation, but you won't be going through it by yourself. You'll have a God who has all power to help you through what you go through. And so if you're here today, you've never acknowledged your sin, you've never entered into a relationship with Jesus Christ, never called out to him to be your Savior, never called out to him and said, Lord, help me. We earnestly plead for you to come and give us your hand and allow us to lead you into that new life. If you've already given your heart to God in salvation and you're without a church home, we ask you to come and become a member of our church fellowship. As we stand all over the church, all over the building, we invite you to come.